So very good morning, students. So today we are going to perform our third experiment. That is experiment number 3. Okay. Now, so the name of the experiment, that is aim, is to verify Kirchhoff's voltage law. So today we are going to perform our this experiment. Now, what actually this Kirchhoff's voltage law, or this is also termed as KVL, states. Okay. It states that the algebraic sum of all voltages, whether it is source voltage and voltage drop, in a closed path or in a closed loop is zero. Okay. So this KVL law is for the closed path or the closed loop or the closed network. Okay. And it states that the algebraic sum of all the voltages around a closed loop is zero, or we can just, for example, I am going to draw here a simple closed loop having four load. Just check it here. Yeah, this is a closed loop, okay, having four load, okay, divided by R. So if these are the nodes C, D, then the sum of the voltages drops, the all the voltage drops which are across this, just name it by 1, 2, 3, or 4. So the voltage drop across this R1, R2, R3 and R4 is 0. Their sum is 0. So it can be termed as like this, that VAB or VR1 plus VBC plus VCD plus VDA is equal to 0. This is what Kirchhoff's law states. So in other words, we can also say that if there is any voltage source here, okay, if I am going to add here a voltage source, okay, source here, suppose I am adding a source here as, then the voltage drops across all of these loads would be equal to the net voltage of my source. We can call at that time that VAB plus VBC plus VCD plus VDA, that is the V of R1, V of R2 plus V across R3 plus V across R4 is equal to the voltage of source. This is what, in another way, Kirchhoff's law states. Okay, this Kirchhoff's law is also called Kirchhoff's mesh rule, Kirchhoff's second rule also. Second rule, why? Because Kirchhoff's has also given one more rule, that is called Kirchhoff's current law. That is Kirchhoff's first rule. Okay, and KVL is the Kirchhoff's second rule. So now we are going to perform our experiment. So I am going to brush this thing out. Now for performing our experiment, we will need some equipments. So I am going to write here equipments required. So for this KVL, what are those equipments which we need? Firstly, we do need a breadboard. Okay. In which we are going to draw a circuit. Okay. Manually. Now, the second thing which we need is our DC power source. So the second one is our DC power source. Now the third one which is required is our voltmeter to check the voltage drops. Okay, in this case also we are going to use multimeter acting as voltmeter. As multimeter can be used to check the voltages, it can also check the current value also. But here we need is it as a voltmeter. Now we do need connecting wires also, resistors also. So I am going to write here resistors. So I am going to take here two resistances. Okay, first one of 1 kilo ohm and the second one of value 470 ohm. Okay, so these two resistors I am going to use here. Now one more thing, connecting wires. So these are all those equipment components part. So these are all the equipments which we need to perform our experiment. Okay, so now I am going to draw the circuit diagram. Here I am giving a voltage source. I am going to provide two resistors here. The first one is R1, the second one is R2. And I am going to close the loop here. Remember always that KVL applied for the closed loop or closed path. So now remember, every time when we were using ammeter, we are going to use that thing in series, but voltmeter is connected in parallel. So if this one is our R1, if this one is our R2, suppose R2 is 470 ohm and this one is 1 kilo ohm, then we are going to connect voltmeter here in the parallel. Suppose this is V1 and suppose this one is my V2, the second voltmeter. So I am going to connect both the voltmeter in parallel to both the resistors. Okay. Now, since we have taken the value of resistance, now I am going to give value to my voltage. Suppose we are going to take 10 volt. Okay. So, this is the positive side of this voltage source. This is the negative part. Now, since this one is the positive side of this voltage source, so the positive side of voltmeter would be here and the negative side would be here. Similarly, V2 positive side would be here and negative side would be at this side. Okay, so now what do we need? We need to firstly calculate that what are the voltage drops which is present in the circuit across R1 and R2 theoretically, and then we will find out the voltage drops across R1 and R2 practically, and we'll find out that whether those voltage which are coming theoretically or practically does complies with this Kirchhoff's voltage law or not. Now for compliance with this Kirchhoff's voltage law, what do we need? It is needed to be proved that this voltage source V suppose term it as V. V should be equal to V1 plus V2. If this happens, then it would be proved that yeah, this circuit is in compliance with Kirchhoff's voltage law. Okay, if this V is not equal to V1 plus V2, then that would mean that the circuit is not following the Kirchhoff's voltage law. Okay, so first thing what we are going to do, we are going to find out the theoretical values of these V1 and V2. So for this thing, first we are going to find out the net resistance or the resistance equivalent of this circuit. So the resistance equivalent, since both the resistance are connected in series, so resistance equivalent would be R1 plus R2. Okay, so just I am going to check this up. Now R equivalent is R1 plus R2, so when you will combine this one with this one, when you will add this, you will get the resistance of across 1470 ohm. Okay, since it is 1000 ohm and this one is of 470 ohm, so my R equivalent is 1470 ohm. Okay, so now by the help of Ohm's law, you could find out that what is the current which is flowing in the circuit. Okay, so for that thing we need use that Ohm's law. For that thing, using the formula, we will get that 10 is equal to I, which is flowing in the circuit. Okay, it's right here I, so this one is flowing in the circuit, I into 1470. This means that I is equal to 10 divided by 1470. So we could calculate this value manually or by help of any calculator. So the value of I which we will get would be around 0.0068 ampere. Okay, so for this V1 we are going to just multiply this with 1 kilo ohm. Okay, so the V1 we will get, we are going to just multiply it by 1000, we will get the value of 6.8. Okay, this is the value of our V1. Now for V2, a voltage of 3.2 okay volts. So these two values we have calculated practically. Now practically it seems fine that here V1 plus V2 is equal to V. Okay, so it seems that theoretically this circuit is in compliance with the KVL law, but now we do need to see practically also that whether this thing is true or not. So now we will move on to our hardware part. So these are my equipments which I require. This is my DC power source. This one is the multimeter which I am going to use as my voltmeter. This one we will use for measuring V2 voltage. By this multimeter, the left one, we will be using it to measure the value of V1. And this is my breadboard here. Just see it. This I will use to perform my experiment. Now we do need more things also, like resistance. Just see here, these are the resistances, two resistance. This one is of 1 kilo ohm and this one is of 470 ohm, and the connecting wires which I have already cut it down. Now we will make our connection. So these are my resistance. So I am going firstly to bend the end of the resistance. Let's see here. The ends are bended. So now I would insert it in the breadboard. So this first resistance, which is of 1 kilo ohm, is inserted. Now I am going to connect a wire, a connecting wire, in the series of this resistance. I have just see rounded this wire also, turned this ends of this wires also towards downward. Now I am going to connect it in series with my this resistance. Just see here, I have connected it properly. Now I am going to connect my second resistance, that is of 470 ohm. So firstly I am going to turn the ends of this resistance, and now I am going to connect this resistance also in series by inserting the ends properly. So just see, I have inserted it properly. Now just check whether these things are in series or not. Just check here, all of these vertical line are shorted internally. So I have connected the connecting wire here just below this first resistance, and I have shorted this end and this end by the help of this connecting wire, or we can say I have made a direct connection. Okay, and since whole of this vertical line is shorted internally in the breadboard, that's why I have connected this resistance here in this vertical column pore. Okay, so both of my these resistance are short connection. So both of these resistance are connected in series. If you want, you can check also the color code here. In the 470 ohm, just check it here, the color coding. Its first color is yellow, then afterwards it is violet, and then brown, then a golden color band, that is of tolerance, is also present here. So firstly the yellow, that is 4, okay, then that of the violet, which resembles of 7, that means 4 7. The third one would be the multiply one, that is 10 to the power 1, so 47 into 10, that is 470, and the last one, the gold one, that is of tolerance, ±5%. Similarly, you can calculate the color code of this first resistance also. So now I am going to connect my voltmeter connection here. Okay, so I am going to connect the voltmeter connection. So now I am going to connect the first voltmeter end here. See, this is the red wire which I am going to insert here at the first end of this resistance, and here is the negative end of this voltmeter. The color of this wire is blue, so I am going to just insert it in my breadboard. So just see, I have connected my first voltmeter ends in parallel with the R1. Now I am going to connect my second voltmeter. Its first end is here, which I am going to connect in parallel with the R2 resistance here, and the negative end of this multimeter I am going to connect at R2 other end. Okay, so this end I have connected the negative end of
my second voltmeter. This one, this wire is the negative end of my first voltmeter, and this wire is my positive end of my first voltmeter. So these two wires are of first voltmeter, and these two wires are of second voltmeter. Now I am going to connect my power source also here. So I am going to connect this side by the negative source, the negative end of the power source, and at this side I am going to connect the power source positive end. Okay, so just see here, this is my full of connection. Okay, and I am going to give you the full view of the circuit. Just see here, this is how our whole circuit looks like. This is the breadboard connection. This one is the voltmeter 1, this one is the voltmeter 2, and this is my DC power source. Okay, so firstly what I am going to do, I am going to switch on my voltmeters. So just see here, I have put the knob of voltmeter to 20 volt so that it could measure a maximum of 20 volt. Since in theory value we have seen that the value would be around 6.8 volt or something around that. So if you are going to rotate my knob at 2 volt, then at that time this voltmeter can measure maximum of 2 volt. It would not be possible for this voltmeter to measure it, to measure the value more than 2 volt. So at the time of connection, at the time of observations, we will just rotate it to check that what is the actual value of voltage which I am going to get from the circuit. So just check this one also, then this one also, the knob is at 20 volt, so I am going to just increase it to 200 volt. Okay, so now this second voltmeter is able to measure 200 volts voltage. And just see this end, this red wire and this black wire is connected properly. This one is in volt 1 and this one is the COM 1. So now I am going to switch on my DC power source and I will provide the voltage here. So this one is my DC power source. I am going to switch it on. Just see here, it is currently showing 0 volt. Now I am going to steadily increase the voltages of this DC power source. I am going to increase here, and in back I am going also to just power on my multimeters. So I have switched on my multimeters also. So firstly I am going to give here the voltage by the coarse button, since the fine button would lead to very small rise of voltage. Now it is 9.6, 9.8 volt. Now I am going to use the fine tuning to make this volt rise up to 10 volt. So now this is 10 volt, and just see here the readings of my voltmeter. So just see here, the second voltmeter reading is 3.24 volt, and in the first one it is showing overload. Overload means that the voltage of the circuit in which this voltmeter is connected is greater than the knob on which we have set. We have set it to 2 volt. Now I would even increase this knob to right side so that it could measure a voltage up to 20 volt. So just see here, now this voltmeter is able to measure 6.895 volt. So the first V1 That is 6.895 is measured by the first voltmeter, and the second voltmeter is reading the voltage of 3.24 when my voltage source is giving 10 volt. So just look it, and this is my whole of the circuit. You could see here that the voltage is 10 volt and my first voltmeter is reading 6.896 volt and the second voltmeter is reading 3.24 volt. Now these values I will check with the theoretical one, and we will verify that whether KVL is applicable on this circuit or not. So now I am going to steadily lower down the voltage of my DC power source. So just check it here. I am decreasing it, and now it is decreased to zero. I am going to this DC power source. Okay. Now we will switch off the voltmeter also, the first one and the second. So now here you can see our observations, both of the voltmeter are present here and our DC power source also. Now I am going to write down the observations in my observation table. So I am going to draw the observation table here. Firstly, I am going to write the theoretical value, okay? And then the practical value. So firstly, I am going to write down the theoretical value of V1. Okay, so V1, here you can see we have taken by the formula, we have got 6.8 volt. Okay, so just write here volt value, just leave this place. Okay, now the practical V1, you can see here it is around 6.87. I'm taking here two decimal place. Okay, for the practical one here, if you will take only one digit decimal place, then you will get exact 6.8. okay, but we are taking the two decimal place here. Similarly for V2, the theoretical value which is present here is 3.2 volt and the practical value here is 3.21 volt. Okay, so now I am going to write the V, that is equal to V1 plus V2. Okay, so this V, which is equal to V1 plus V2, if you will just check it here, in the theoretical you will find exact 10, but now in the practical, when you find it, you will get it the value of 8, 0, 10. So here I am getting 10.08 volt as my practical value for V, and in the theoretical value I am getting only 10 volt. So firstly I am going to switch off my voltmeters and the DC power source. Now the value of voltage by DC power source is 0. I am going to switch this off, and also I am going to switch off my multimeters here. Now again just check it here, the value of practical thing and the theoretical one are little different. They are equivalent but not the equal one. Now what's the reason? The reason here, there is some tolerance present in both of the resistance, okay, of plus minus 5% because of gold band was present in both the resistance. So plus minus 5% of
tolerance were present in both the resistance. That's the reason the practical value of these two resistance were different from that of the theoretical value. That's the reason that again we have got some different value. But if you will see this, V1 plus V2 is equal to V in both the theoretical and practical case. That means that the circuit is in compliance with KVL. So we can write in the conclusion that yes, the circuit is in compliance with the KVL law or KVL rule. But since there was tolerance present in the resistance, that's why practical value and theoretical value somehow got differentiated, or the values are somewhat different. Okay, so you can write this thing in our conclusion. Now remember one thing here, that since I have made the circuit very swiftly and very cleanly, that's the reason there is no issue from the circuit. Okay, if you made a circuit which is not tight, okay, if you are making loose connections, then also you will find that here the fluctuations, the deviations would be much more, okay, than this one. So since my circuit was okay, that's the reason that only tolerance here is the reason of deviation from the theoretical and the practical voltage. Okay, so this is the final part of this experiment. Thank you.